What do you mean, no free refills? Hello everyone and welcome. Today I answer the question, can you beat Elden Ring without drinking? Since there aren't any weapon restrictions, any starting class would work, though the three casters would be less than optimal, but I choose the bandit because bleed dagger and buckler parry. This challenge is dedicated to my best friend of nearly 15 years now, the Duke of Craft. He made this incredible crimson flask for me, then of course had to issue a challenge, and I believe his exact words were, can you beat Elden Ring with no flasks? Well, Mr. Craft, I'll do you one better. How about I beat it without flasks or the physic? And you know what? While I'm at it, how about I don't eat anything either? Ha ha! Why do I do this to myself? Anyway, the man worked real hard on this, so if y'all could check him out and show him some love, I'd appreciate it. Thinking about it, I guess this is essentially a pseudo no-hit run. I mean, with armor and talismans, I'm able to make a couple mistakes per fight. I don't have to be perfect, I just have to be good enough. Which is great, because that's basically my motto in life. Best part about this run is not needing to waste my time collecting seeds and tears. Still get the two halves of the medallion, though. I also take the time to kill Greyall for some free runes, but that poses a question. What do I do with them? Leveling Vigor makes sense because it is directly related to how many times I can get hit, but without being able to heal, it seems kind of pointless. Endurance would let me wear heavier armor, again increasing the amount of times I can make a mistake, but if I just never make a mistake, who am I kidding, I'm gonna get smacked by everything. Lastly, Strength and Dex will up weapon damage, but I haven't actually decided what weapon I'll end up using. In the end, I decided to level Vigor, Endurance, and Dex, the plan being high health and low equip load so I can light roll with whatever weapon I use. As much as I love the dagger class of weapons, and I really did plan on doing more of the run with it, I decided I might as well collect a longer lasting weapon. I heard you like knives. Well, how about longer knife? Margit actually gives me a bit of an issue here because I'm stubborn and wanted to parry him. Had I just went full dodge mode like I normally do, he would have been a cakewalk, but I told myself I picked the bandit class and already dropped the dagger, so I can't just abandon the buckler so easily. After 5 or so attempts, I had had enough playing around and put his foolish ambitions to rest, going ultra instinct and parrying literally everything he threw at me. The whole fight took just under a minute, and that's with an unupgraded katana. I guess those levels in vigor were a poor decision, and I'm definitely not overconfident about this run now. Well, that's embarrassing. Unfortunately, Godric here managed to pull one over on me because I thought he would be easy even with an unupgraded katana. I mean, I was right, he is still easy, I just made a stupid mistake. I didn't get to show it off properly in my no-walk video, but I absolutely love standing still and his big display of a tornado fuel jump attack just misses. Anyway, he goes down on the second try. I still wasn't completely sure what weapon I would end up using, so I wanted to grab the bell bearing for easy access to smithing stones. Okay, Mr. Crystallion, just turn your head and cough. Up next is the Academy, and the Red Wolf, good boy that he is, wasn't an issue. However, this is about where I noticed how much I actually rely on healing. Like everyone, I usually make small mistakes in a normal run, but not being able to undo them with a flask really adds up. I can't wait for the bosses to start doing real damage. Anyway, using my single-digit IQ, I outplay Moongrum, then take on Rennala. Phase 1 isn't an issue because, you know, I can actually hit the Sweetings to break her shield. Phase 2... I don't have words, honestly. I had assumed there wouldn't be an issue because I have a normal melee weapon, but even though I had no expectations, she still let me down. The whole fight lasted like 35 seconds, which, to be fair, is like double my normal time with hot single moms in my area. I know I got lucky with her not summoning anything, but like, Rennala, please, you have to fight me. Just smack me with your cane, literally anything. But alas, she did absolutely nothing, and I just end up feeling bad for taking her out. Well, she hasn't been taken out since Radagon dumped her, so maybe in the end I did her a favor. Moving along. At this point, I have just been kinda coasting on my skills, but it's high time I start to put together an actual plan, so in no particular order, I go get the Blue Dancer charm, give Raya back her necklace, punch Loretta in the face, hope Ronnie doesn't mind that I beat up her mom, go to the Lux Runes to get the Ritual Sword Talisman, backtrack to the Death Touch Catacombs for the Crimson Dagger Talisman, then finally take on Radahn. I was a little afraid of this fight, considering I can't heal and that I took off more armor to boost the Blue Dancer charm's effect, so getting hit would be less than ideal, but fortunately the one time I potato and he does successfully smack me, I was holding block, which surprisingly stopped a lot of damage. The rest of the fight goes smoothly, I even managed to nab an unintended stance break, something I can't do even when trying. Radahn falls on the first try. I pick up the Misericord because I totally didn't forget it earlier, then face the Draconic Tree Sentinel. So, the Demon Lorax here can be parried, and it's not even that hard with a couple of his attacks, but he can't be riposted and... why am I doing so little damage? Oh. That. Okay, yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, I probably deserve that. Well, whatever, it's easier to just dodge him and stick to the shield side anyway. I go ahead and give myself that one extra strength and it's off to meet the Ghost Chad himself, Goldfree. Being one of my favorite fights, he's not going to be a problem. Great start. Aside from that rocky beginning, the fight is easy. In fact, he only manages to hit me one other time, and it's because I got greedy. I'm sure I won't make any stupid mistakes in our second encounter. I made a quick stop to grab the ritual shield talisman, but honestly, I'm not sure if it ever actually made a difference in how many hits I took for a boss to kill me. Then it's off to fight Morgott. Similar to his earlier encounter, he was giving me a lot more trouble than normal, and I think the issue was, again, that I wanted the fight to be more parry-focused instead of just playing evasive like I normally do. I did learn here that you can actually parry him to phase transition. I don't think that would ever be useful, but I enjoy the idea that being slapped in the face with a small shield makes him so angry he explodes. I will add that I got pretty lucky with how the fight ended. He doesn't often do the jump attack in phase 2, but he did, and I sprinted under him for the old 2 charge attacks followed by a jumping attack. Having done so many runs, I know this leads to a guaranteed stagger with at least most weapons. Then, because of how the game handles boss parries, he was only one away from being riposted. He went from 40% of his health to dead in like 12 seconds. Wish I could do that on every boss, but it's usually them doing it to me. I heard you like longer knife, so how about longest knife? I didn't really ever intend the katana class to be the main weapon of this run, but I do like the way the power stance moveset looks, plus it's fast enough that I don't usually have to worry about overcommitting, so I guess it's fine. I also quickly stopped to grab the wing sword insignia. It has the most utility against big slow bosses, which is a great segue for the fire giant. Not being bound by any lengthy attack animations or the inability to move my character's legs, the fight is pretty easy. Phase 1 just stick to his ankles, and phase 2 I learned that this game cheats and I hate it so much. The only issue I had with the fire giant aside from his homing fire bullshit attack was any singular mistake would likely cost me half of my health bar or more. So there was no it's okay to be risky here moments like with other fights, but in the end he falls before me. Ignore the fact that I'm missing some health, I won, he lost, that's what matters. Before fighting everyone's favorite duo boss, I prep by collecting a couple of pots, some flowers, the axe talisman, and some mushrooms. What, you thought I was gonna do this fight without sleep? Listen, I'm crazy, but I'm not stupid. Sleep makes this fight so ludicrously easy, it isn't even funny. Like, they go from one of the hardest fights to one of the easiest fights just because they need to take a nap. I wasn't exactly optimized for damage though, so I needed to be a little careful, especially because getting hit by rollout would probably mean death, but in the end, the duo are put to rest. Wombo combo, that ain't Falco! I don't know how many people are gonna get that reference. Malekith! Plan! Don't get hit. That's all I got. Phase 1 isn't a problem really, just bait the dagger dragon, dodge through his projectiles. Phase 2 is where it gets a bit spicy, mostly because of Destined Death. Earlier, I said I wasn't sure if the ritual shield talisman ever helped, but it 100% saved me here. He hit me twice, and the first hit was much weaker. Not sure why the health drain was so little, maybe it's also affected by ritual shield, I don't know, but I won't complain because I made the anime comeback and Malekith falls on the first try. For Gideon, I thought about running around and collecting things to try and one-shot him with inescapable frenzy, but honestly, running him through with a sword is just as satisfying. Okay, the real reason is I'm lazy, but I'm not wrong about the sword thing. He did actually scare me in the end because I have such a hard time dodging the three rings attack, but patience is a virtue and we cut him down to size. Godfrey, for the first time in a long time, was giving me issues. I'm not completely sure why either. I think it's just a combination of him doing big damage and me being, well, bad. But I decide if there was ever a boss to use jump attacks on, it's him. So back at Stormvale, I quickly grab the Claw Talisman. This proved to be a great decision for Godfrey. Unfortunately, I only have 2 brain cells. One controls movement and the other attacking, and the movement one kinda stopped working and I literally jumped into Horlew's grab, so good job, me. Fortunately, I play a little safer on the next try and he goes down. Radagon of the Golden Order, easily one of the best fights in this game. I mean, the soundtrack alone is just straight fire, I could put it over a photo of paint drying and it would still be exciting. The Nagakiba isn't the best weapon for fighting him, but he's so easy to parry it doesn't really matter. I seriously think he is the easiest enemy to parry in this whole game, which is hilarious considering he's the final boss. Alright, I still have the stupid space fish. I no-hit Radagon only to get hit by that attack, one of the slowest things Elden Beast can do? Oh well, eventually we slice up some space sashimi and we have beaten Elden Ring without drinking. Or eating. Is what I would like to say, but there are some other bosses still standing. I want some free and easy runes, so I decided to take on Placidusax. He's a disappointment. Shocking, I know. I really wish they would amp up this fight, like the spectacle is nice and the soundtrack is electrifying, but the actual combat is boring. Oh well, as long as I keep myself grounded and fight near the edge of the arena, he's easy. Oh, I can't even finish him while he's doing his laser attack. That, I really need to re-optimize my damage. Or I could not do that and make the game harder on myself. I'm sure we both know which option I picked. Normally, I just do the two Dragon Bros together because, well, they're both dragons and that's it. But today, I felt like changing it up, so I head into Nokron and fight myself. Wow, I died. Wait, so does that mean I lost or won since I'm fighting myself? Ah, well, just to make it even, I run myself through with a sword. I grab the Finger Slayer blade and take it back to Ronnie, who trades it out for this lovely wooden statue. I totally didn't get ripped off in that deal or anything. Anyway, doing that, I can take this teleporter and make my way to the Lake of... Rot. Huh. This might be a problem. There are platforms that can be raised, but getting rotted at all would mean certain death because I can't heal through it or heal the status, so... You know what? That's a problem for future me. I grab the left half of the secret medallion and make my way up north to fight Commander Nile. I was a bit worried about how this fight would start because of his summons, but the AI will never learn how to handle the run away then turn jump attack strat. Nile himself isn't really hard, and before long I have a completed secret medallion. Making my way through the Hallig Tree, I fight Loretta, who is the opposite of a problem, then I take on Melania. Is what I would like to say, but Right, so I take the statue and flip the tower upside down to grab the Curse Mark of Death, then head into the sewers, grab Moog's Shackle, and take on Ghost Satan. The Shackle wasn't at all necessary for this version of him, I just figured I'd need it for later, and why not use it now? You know, I didn't want to do the two Dragon Remembrances back to back, but I guess the game really didn't like that I messed with the narrative continuity of this script, so it pushed me back towards it. Thea's champions are... there? At this point, my combat flowchart is NPC enemy? Jump attack. And hey, if it works right. Fortisax, though, well, he isn't so much a hard boss, it's just the fight is kind of a fustercluck. Don't get me wrong, I appreciate that the fight is involved. So many big boss battles in these games boil down to stand behind boss and slash at ankles, but there's a lot going on here. He has lightning that explodes into death clouds, massive AoE attacks like his fire breath and lightning cleave, claw swipes that leave lingering lightning, and if you're ever under him, there is the timed lightning debuff. Honestly, it feels more like a WoW raid boss than a FromSoft one, but either way, cool fight even if I did end up getting wombo comboed by his attacks. Doesn't matter because he too falls before me in all my dehydrated glory. Next up is Regal Ancestor Spirit. Go ahead and comment down below if you think this is the run where Bambi poses a problem. I mean, I can't heal right, surely he must be a threat now. For those of you that voted yes, well, you must be new here, welcome to the channel. This boss even tried to heal in front of me and still disappointed me. Maybe one day, Bambi, maybe one day. Moving right along, I take on the big snake man Rykard. Fortunately, this fight isn't hard because, and this might be a surprise, the Serpent Hunter Spear is in fact not a drink, so it's okay to use. He really isn't that hard, and the first hit of Great Serpent Hunt doesn't cost too much FP, so I can just stunlock phase 2. With him down, there are only 3 bosses left, Moog and 2 different Rot Pools. The one before Melania is relatively small, in fact, with 1 Estus you can make it all the way to the Grace before dying, but obviously that's not an option for me. Instead, I grab Flame Cleanse Me, the 2-finger heirloom from the Purified Runes, and buy a regular Finger Seal. Flame Cleanse Me is a fantastic incantation that cures rot and poison for a relatively low mana cost, and just like that, I'm across the pool. Now, all I have to do is beat Melania. Without healing. Yay. I gave her a fair few number of attempts, but she always managed to get the better of me. Then, I realized I wasn't doing the fight with all the tools available to me. So, I grab the Glintstone Craftsman Cookbook and make some freezing pots. Honestly, they might not have even been necessary. On the successful attempt, I used one to interrupt her phantom attack, which just served to give me a heart attack because the first clone is kinda just hanging out. Then I threw one randomly, hoping it would do more damage than it did. Oh well, eventually she goes down, so let's head back to the Rot Swamp. Using those raised platforms from earlier, I am able to make it pretty close to the end, but ultimately I don't have enough mana. But don't worry, I have a plan. The easy way out would be to respec into mine to have plenty of Flame Cleanse Me cast, but where's the fun in that? So instead, I head to Mount Gilmer for the mushroom set. Don't I look... infected. The stat that governs rot buildup is immunity, and this set gives a lot of it. In theory, I should be able to stand in the rot swamp a lot longer without being afflicted. Oh yeah, that bar is like twice as large, no problem at all. In fact, I didn't even need Flame Cleanse Me to make it all the way across the rot swamp. So, that's a little anticlimactic. Estelle, can you provide the viewers with a riveting and engaging story? No, no he cannot, and that was an easy first try. With him down, that only leaves the Lord of Blood himself, Moog. Why? Why is it always you? Why are you always the pain in my ass in these runs? I'm sure a lot of you probably guessed Moke here is the reason why I banned drinking and not just healing. Using the purifying crystal tier would allow me to live through knee heal, which would in turn make this a normal boss fight. In the footage you're seeing now, I played phase 1 perfectly, and yet I still die because of his phase transition. So how do we beat him? Well, essentially, we either need to find a way to outheal his attack or burst him down in phase 1. There are already several really cool ways to burst him down, so let's see if I can figure out how to outheal him without flasks instead. First, I grab the Blessed Dew Talisman and the Icon Shield. These two items will give passive health regeneration. Admittedly, it isn't much, but some is literally infinitely better than none. Next, I get the Lord of Blood's Exaltation. My thinking here is that since Knee Heal is an attack that just causes instant blood loss, this will buff whatever I do when it goes off. Next, I get Prayerful Strike from this Teardrop Scarab, and lastly, I grab a big Unga Bunga weapon to put it on, the Giant Crusher. I wanted to be able to cast it at least 3 times and figured I'd need more mana, but surprisingly, Prayerful Strike is relatively low cost. All I had to do was respec for strength to actually use the hammer, and with that, let's give him a try. So the plan is to not get hit at all during phase 1, which of course immediately went out the window, but beyond that, I use the superior poise break potential of Great Hammers and jump attack my way to phase 2. When he starts casting Blood Boon Ritual, I just spam the Ash of War. The attack is too slow to get off between the first and second blood loss, but can be done between the second and third, and... I lived, bitch! I mean, he immediately killed me after that, but whatever, now I knew it was possible. On the very next attempt, I held nothing back, throwing his shackle down and jump attacking him into oblivion. Healing through knee heal, the Lord of Blood falls before me, and I have beaten Elden Ring without drinking. I guess it's true what they say, you either die a dex main or live long enough to see yourself become a strength main. Thank you everyone for watching, and an extra special thanks to my patrons. Stay beautiful, y'all. If you like the video, please consider giving a like and subscribing. It helps the channel out way more than you know, and until next time, my friends, don't you dare go hollow.